Well, hello everyone. Last time we have stopped here. Now we are beginning here. So classification of bones based on their locations. In adult, we have around 206 named bones of human skeleton. So this human skeleton can be divided into two parts. The one is axial skeleton. The other is appendicular skeleton. So this at birth skeleton consists of approximately around 270 bones. So we have the one group is axial skeleton, the other is appendicular skeleton. Both of our 206 named bones in adult. So axial skeleton is about 80 bones, whereas appendicular skeleton is 126. 64 is upper extremity and 62 is the lower extremity. In together 126 bones are appendicular skeletons, forms appendicular skeletons, whereas axial skeleton forms composed of about 80 bones. So axial skeleton is forms the long axis of the body. About 80 bones forms axial skeleton: skull, hyoid bone, auditory ossicles, vertebral column, and thoracic cage. By the way, appendicular skeleton is about 80. These are the first one is cranium. The first one is at cranium. Cranium contains about 8 bones. And the second is face. Face contains about 14 bones, and hyoid bone is one, and auditory ossicles is six pairs, like we will see later, malus, incus, and stapes, and vertebral column is 26. Vertebral column is 26, and the sternum, thoracic cage, contains sternum and ribs. Sternum is one and ribs is 24 pairs. So in together they are 80. In together they are 80. Whereas in appendicular skeleton, we can divide into upper extremity with pectoral girdle and lower extremity with pectoral girdle. So the upper extremity is 64. So the 64 is clavicle is 2, scapula is 2, and humerus is 2, ulna is 2, radius 2, and the carpal bones is 16, 8, 8, and the carpal and metacarpalis is 10, 5, 5 in 2 hands, and phalanges is 28, 14 in one hand, 14 in other hand. So in together they are 64. And the other is lower extremity with pelvic girdle. So hip bone, pelvic bone, or coxal bone is 2, whereas femur is 2, left and right, and patella is 2, fibula is 2, tibia is 2, tarsal bone is 14, so 7, 7 in left and right leg, and metatarsals are 10, 5, 5, and phalanges is 28, 14 in one, in the left leg, and 14 in the right leg. So in together 64 plus 62, they are 126. They are 126. So when you see this, this is the green one is appendicular skeleton, axial skeleton. This is the green one is axial skeleton, whereas this one and this one is upper extremity with a pectoral girdle. So this is the upper extremity, this is the lower extremity with pelvic girdle. So this lower extremity and this upper extremity together gives us appendicular skeleton. So appendicular skeleton, so this the white one is 62, whereas this is a green one is 64. So in together, I mean, The upper is this one, upper extremity is 64 and the lower extremity is 62. In together they are 126 and this is 80. 80 totally, they are 206. They are 206. This is the cranium. This is the cranium. So the cranium contains 8 bones. The cranium contains 8 bones. So from 8, frontal bone is 1. Parental bone is 2 pairs, temporal bone is 2, they are paired, this is temporal bone, this is parental bone. So occipital bone is 1, sphenoid bone is 1, and ethmoid bone is 1. So in total there are 8 bones. So frontal, parental, temporal, occipital, sphenoid and ethmoid bones constitutes the cranium. So the other is face. Face is this one. Faces contains 14 bones. Faces contains 14 bones. These bones are nasal, maxillary bone, zygomatic bone, mandible bone, lacrimal bone, palatine bone, and inferior conchae and vomer bone are constituting the facial bones. So when you see the number, when you see it's the number, nasal is 2, maxillary is 2, zygomatic is 2, mandible is 1, single bone, lacrimal is 2, palatine 2, inferior concha is 2, and vomer is 2, and vomer is 1, it is single or unpaired. So in total they are 14. So the next axial skeleton is ear bones or auditory ossicles. So ear bones in the left ear is 3, in the right ear is 3, there are 6. So their name is malus, incus and stapes. We can say mis, M is malus, I is incus and S is stapes. So mis means from outer to inner, from outer ear to the inner ear. They are mis, malus, incus, stapes. So the 3 bone in pair, left and right, they are 6. They are tutu. So the other is the hyoid bone. Hyoid bone is here, found here, below the tongue. So in the hyoid bone, hyoid bone is one bone, single bone. The hyoid bone does not have any communication or articulation with any other bone. So it is a unique bone, a single bone or unique bone. Hyoid bone is a unique bone. So the other is the spinal column or vertebral column. Vertebral column is this one. So vertebral column is there 26. So when we sum them, for instance, cervical vertebra is 7, and thoracic vertebra is 12, and lumbar vertebra is 5, and sacrum is 1, and coccyx is 1. So in total, there are 26. So the other is the sternum. Here is the sternum and here is ribs. So sternum is 1, ribs is 24, this is 12, this is 12, they are 24. So 24 plus sternum 1 is 25. So if you want to classify ribs, we have true ribs and false ribs. So true ribs is 14 and false ribs is 10. So in together they are 25 with sternum. They are 24, so with sternum they are 25. So so now we are completed the axial skeleton. So we have it is 80 bone together. In total is 80 bone. So this is axial skeleton with their names. So the other is appendicular skeleton here. When we see appendicular skeleton can divide into upper extremity and lower extremity. So the upper extremity is 64, the lower extremity is the upper extremity is 64 and the lower extremity is 62. So when we see the upper extremity, this is a clavicle, and behind is there is this is scapula. Scapula, clavicle is 2, left and right, scapula is 2, so there are 4. So humerus, here is humerus is 2, left and right, So radius, this is radius. So radius is on the great thumb or on the thumb side. So radius is two left and right, and this is ulna. Ulna is also two left and right. It's found on the side of little finger. So then carpals, here is carpals, carpal pons. Carpal pons is 4-4 arranged in two rows into 4-4. So 4-4 is 8 in one hand, 8 in other hand, so they are 16. So next is metacarpals. Metacarpals is it's for metacarpals is 1 2 3 5 in left and right, and 5 in one hand and 5 in another hand, so they are 10. So the other is phalanges. Phalanges is 28. So you can count the three digits, or this is proximal phalanges, middle phalanges, and distal phalanges. So 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 and 1 2 3, and the thumb is 2. So together they are 14. So with the other hand it will come up with 28. So this is all are 64 bones. The other is the lower extremity. The lower extremity starts with pelvic girdle or hip or coxal bone. So this and this one is 2, the left and right hip bone is 2. So 2, and this is femur. Femur is 2 left and right, and patella is 2 left and right, and this is tibia. Tibia is 2 left and right, and fibula is 2 left and right, and tarsal bones. Here tarsal bones is 7 in the left and 7 in the right, they are 14. Then metatarsal is 5 10, and phalanges is 14 in one leg, 14 in one leg, they are 28. So in together it will come up with 62. So in general 62, 64, 126, and this 80, totally it will come up with 206. This is all over revision of the skeletal system. This is all over skeleton, all over structure of skeletal system. So now we are almost skeletal system is completed, but when we see detailly each bone, like 206 bone, when we are observing in detail 206 bone, so we will cover the chapter. We will cover the chapter and the joints and ligaments we will see with another section. So now when you see, this is, as I told you, this is the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. Axial skeleton, this one. Now we will start axial skeleton. So this is the axial skeleton. This is the overall axial skeleton. So this is axial skeleton contains skull, contains cranium and face, hyoid bone, auditory ossicles, vertebral column, thorax, sternum and ribs. Whereas appendicular skeleton is this one and this one. So this is clavicle 2, scapula 2, humerus 2, all this. And pelvic girdles, hip bone, femur, patella, tibia, tarsal, metaphalanges, all are this. In general, they are 406 bones. 126 is a appendicular skeleton, and 18 is axial skeleton. So we have seen in detail. So so the skull. Now we are starting from the axial skeleton. Skull contains by cranial bones and facial bones. Cranial bones are 8, and facial bones is 14. So they are 22. Skull bones are 22. So the cranium is a clavira, cranial vault, plus cranial base or floor is considered as cranium. So cranial base has anterior, middle and posterior cranial fossa. it is detected internally. Just we will observe internally. So contains large cranial cavity and small cavity. Skull contains large cranial cavity within the cranium and small cavities, so like middle ear, inner ear, nasal cavity, and orbits are small cavities, and nasal cavity is very large. And skull is also air-filled cavities that occur in several bones around the nasal cavity are paranasal. So skull also contains paranasal sinuses. Paranasal sinuses are air-filled cavities that occur in several bones around nasal cavity. For instance, around nasal cavity in several bones means paranasal sinuses is found within frontal bone, within maxillary bone, and within siphonoid bone, within ethmoid bone. So sinuses found in frontal bodies, frontal sinus, maxillary sinus, siphonoid sinus, and ethmoid sinus. So has 85 named openings in the skull. Around T5 openings are found in the skull. These openings may be considered as foramina, canals, or fissures, or depressions. So the other is the cranial bones. Now, from the skull, we will see cranial bones, 8 cranial bones. So parental bone is paired, 2, temporal bone is 2, frontal bone is 1, occipital bone is 1, and siphonoid is 1, ethmoid is 1, so they are 8. So this is a frontal bone, this is a frontal bone, this is a parental bone, this is occipital bone, whereas this is the temporal bone, so ethmoid and siphonoid bone is found within here on the base of the cranium, on the middle end, anterior part of the base of the cranium. So when we see when we want to separate cranial bones and facial bones, all this one are considered as cranial bones, whereas this one, the blue one, is considered as facial bones. So this is the facial bones, this is the cranial bones, so this is the parental bone, this is the temporal bone, and this is the occipital bone. So frontal bone is on the front side. So this is frontal, parental, and occipital. This is frontal. This is known as anterior frontal. This is known as posterior frontal. This one is triangular shape is a posterior frontal, whereas this is diamond shaped is anterior frontal. Anterior frontal is found between frontal bone and parental bones, and whereas this one is the occipital bone and parental bone. Posterior frontal. Having this concept, this is overall skull. So this is known as cranium. So this is the base of the skull, cranial base. So this is the cranial base. So this is a frontal bone. This is a this is known as ethmoid bone, whereas this is known as siphonoid bone. So this is occipital bone. This is the largest foramen in the body. It is known as foramen magnum. Foramen magnum, this is foramen magnum. So this is the inferior inferior view. So this is inferior view of the skull. Inferior view of the skull. This is also the internal cranial base. The internal cranial base sectioned from this bone. So this is the inner view, this is the outer view of the inner side of the skull. The inner side of the skull sectioned as just like this, sectioned as this place, and now the superior one is this one, the inferior one is this one, so this is the maxilla, this is a palatine bone, and this is a palatine foramina, and this is the internal nares, this is the boomer bone, and this is a siphonoid bone, the base of the siphonoid bone, on the inferior view of the siphonoid bone, and this, the three holes are foraminas, foramen ovale, foramen spinosum, and foramen lacerum, and And this foramen is known as stylomastoid foramen. This is a jugular foramen. Jugular foramen is found also here. And this is a carotid canal. Carotid canal, this is a foramen magnum. This is a temporal bone. This is mandibular fossa. This is a styloid process. And this is a zygomatic process. This is temporal process. So when you came to this one, as I told you, this is a frontal crest, and as a whole, it is frontal bone. This is a ethmoid bone, and some holes are cribriform plate, whereas this groove is crista galli. Crista galli, and in this area, it is optic foramen. And this is the lesser wing of siphonoid bone, and this is cella torsica, where anterior where pituitary gland found here or placed here, and in this area foramen ovale is found here, foramen spinosum and foramen lyrus lacerum, and this is internal auditory canal, this is jugular foramen. This is hypoglossal canal for cranial nerve 12. Jugular foramen is for cranial nerve 9. So, this is a parental bone, and this is occipital bone. This is internal occipital crest. So, internal occipital protuberance is this one. So now it is frontal bone here, it is parental bone here, and it is temporal bone here, and siphonoid bone is here. This is a facial bonus, this is a zygomatic bone, we will see later. So now let us see frontal bone. Frontal bone is here. So frontal bone forms the anterior roof of the cranium, forehead, the roof of the nasal cavity, and the superior arch of bony orbit. Arch of bony orbit. So thickened ridges or supellary arch supports the eyebrows. So supracillary arch is this one, support the eyebrow is this one, supracillary arch is this one. So supraorbital foramen is here, squamous part is here, squamous part of frontal bone is here. So this is supratemporal line. Supraorbital margin is here. Supraorbital margin is here. Supraorbital foramen is here. So the inner view, when we see the inner view, this is the frontal crest. This is the squamous part. So this is the orbital part. The curved and the base one is the orbital part. Whereas this one, the front part, this one is the squamous part. Whereas folded inferiorly, or the inner part, is known as orbital part, which contains the A. This is a notch for ethmoid bone. So contains supraorbital foramen, like supraorbital vessels passes through it, and allows passage of small nerves and vessels. So nerves and vessels are supraorbital vessels. Supraorbital vessels. So the other is the parental bone. Parental bone is here. They are paired. So left and right parental bones form the most of the cranial roof and part of its lateral wall. So the parental bone one, it forms the roof of the cranium. The other is lateral wall, forms also the lateral wall of the cranium. And the superior and inferior temporal line mark the attachment of temporalis muscle. So temporalis muscle is a muscle of mastication. So it's attached from the superior inferior temporal line. So the superior temporal line one is here, and the inferior temporal line is here. The inferior temporal line is here, and superior temporal line is here. So these are found in the parental bone. So parental eminence or protuberance is the smooth surface superior to temporal lines. So superior to the temporal lines. So so this bone is this part, this protuberance part is considered as the parental eminence. So it is smooth surface superior to temporal lines. So This is the border of squamous sacca, and in this part is the border of sagittal sacca. So now it is this part is known as parental bone. Parental bone, they are two paired. So the third one is the occipital bone. Occipital bone is this part, this one, which contains foramen magnum. So when enlarged, seems like it's like this, and forms the posterior part and most of the base of the cranium. So it's posterior part and the base of the cranium. So foramen magnum, the largest foramen in the skull, pass through it. So this is the foramen magnum. So it's the largest foramen in the skull. So occipital condyle. Occipital condyle, oval process, one on either side of the foramen magnum that articulate with the first cervical vertebra. So occipital condyle is found on the inner side of the on the inner side of the inferior part of the occipital bone. So this bone is occipital condyle bone is articulated with the first cervical vertebra. The first cervical vertebra is atlas bone. So atlas bone is articulated with occipital condyle. So the other is external occipital protuberance. So external occipital protuberance is found on the outer side of this bone. So now we will not see it, but the internal occipital protuberance is this one. But the external one is on the external side. So this area is known as internal occipital crest. This area is known as internal occipital protuberance. This area is fossa of cerebrum. This area is known as fossa for cerebellum. This is foramen magnum. In foramen magnum, like spinal cordis, meninges, and spinal branch of accessory nerve, and other branches pass through it. But in the case of hypoglossal canal is here. Hypoglossal canal is cranial nerve 12, entrance of cranial nerve 12, and this is a groove for sigmoid sinus. This is a jugular notch, and foramen magnum is this one. So this is all about occipital bone. When we see the temporal bone, forms the infralateral walls of the cranium. Infralateral walls of the cranium contribute to the zygomatic arch. So temporal bone and zygomatic bone contributing to form zygomatic arches. So forms the only articulation with mandible. So temporal bone is articulated with mandible. Temporal bone is divided into four parts. The first part is squamous part. The second one is tympanic part, this mastoid part, and petrous part. So the squamous part is a flattened plate on the side of the skull. It bears two prominent features, the zygomatic process and mandibular fossa. And tympanic part contains external acoustic meatus and styloid process. The mastoid part is a part on which mastoid process projects. And the petrous part is houses the structures of middle and inner ear. So let me show you. So this is the tympanic part, temporal bone. So when magnified this part, so it seems like just like this. So this is overall, this is the temporal bone. We can divide into four sections. This part is known as squamous part or squamous bone, and this part is known as tympanic bone or tympanic region or tympanic part. So this part is known as this part is tympanic part, this one is mastoid part, and this one is squamous part. So this one is squamous, this one is mastoid part, and this one is tympanic part. But the inferior portion which cannot view it is petrous part is the inferior base, the base one. So in the base it contains for middle and inner, it serves as a base for inner and middle ear. But this one is tympanic, it contains styloid process and external acoustic meatus. But this one is mastoid part, so contains mastoid process. So this one is also squamous part also contain zygomatic part of squamous bone. Zygomatic part of squamous bone, this is a zygomatic process. So zygomatic process is zygomatic arches formed by two processes, zygomatic process and zygomatic process of temporal bone and temporal process of zygomatic bone. So seems like this. We have said it. So the other bone is the seventh bone is siphonoid bone. Siphonoid bone lies in the middle part of the base of the skull, in the middle part. So the keystone of the cranial floor, because it articulates with all other cranial bones. The keystone of cranial floor, because it articulates with all other cranial bones. By the way, every siphonoid bone articulates with every other bone. So it's very key bone, which is a backbone, serves as backbone. So acts as a bridge uniting the cranial and facial bones. So siphonoid bone acts as a bridge which unites cranial bone and facial bone. So the other is articulates with siphonoid bone, articulates with palatine bone, zygomatic bone, maxilla, boomer of the facial bone. So articulates with just like this. It is shaped like a bat with outstretched wings. A bat means which is it's knife fly. So seems like anthropod bat with outstretched wings. So the other is completes the side of the skull and contributes to the orbits. So have some forms in the side of the skull and contributes some bones to the orbits of the our eye. So it consists of body with laterally projecting greater and lesser wings. So siphonoid bone has body and also two wings. That wing is known as greater wing and lesser wing. The body of siphonoid bone contains siphonoidal sinuses, depression called, and the other also contains a depressed area is called serratorsica. Serratorsica is the anterior pituitary gland found, or anterior pituitary gland is placed, a place where pituitary gland found is serratorsica. So siphonoid bone also contains a pair of trigoid plates. Trigoid have two trigoid plates. The one is lateral trigoid and medial trigoid, projects inferiorly to help formation of the lateral loops of the nasal cavities. So the trigoid plates of the siphonoid bone used us to form the lateral loops of the nasal cavity. The nasal cavity. Now, we are coming. So, by the way, this area is known as ethmoid bone. Whereas this one, bat-like. Whereas this is bat-like appearance is known as siphonoid bone. This area is known as siphonoid bone. So this area is serratorsica, where pituitary gland is found. This is serratorsica. This is ethmoid bone. This is siphonoid bone. This is temporal bone, and this is occipital bone, and this is the frontal bone. So this is the base of the cranium. So the other is the other part is this one. This is siphonoid bone. This is tuberculum ciela, and this is ciela torsica, where the pituitary gland found, and this is dorsum ciela, and siphonoidal spine is here, and foramen spinosum is here, posterior clinoid process here, posterior clinoid process. This is anterior clinoid process. This is a beard-like appearance for pituitary gland. And this is the foramen ovale, this is foramen spinosum, this is foramen rotundum, foramen rotundum, foramen ovale, foramen spinosum. And this is a sphenoid bone. And the other is this is a pterygoid process, this is pterygoid process. So this one is the medial plate of pterygoid process. This is the lateral pterygoid process. This is the medial pterygoid process. This is important to form the lateral wall of the nose. The nose so projects inferiorly from the siphonoid bone. So siphonoidal sinus is here. We have four types of sinus: ethmoidal, siphonoidal, frontal, and maxillary. So siphonoidal sinus is found here. So this is a trochoidal canal. This is orbital surface of greater wing. This is generally this is a greater wing. This is a lesser wing. Siphonoid bone has two wings: lesser wing and greater wing. And by the way, this is superior orbital fissure. There is also another place, inferior orbital fissure in the face bones, but this one is known as superior orbital fissure. So this one is lesser wing, this one is the greater wing, this one is the lesser wing. So this is all about the siphonoid bone found on in this frontally. It can be viewed just like this. The other is the ethmoid bone. It is the eighth bone, the last bone. So ethmoid bone is located in the anterior portion of the floor of the cranium, between the orbit, where it forms the roof of the nasal cavity. So it's anterior portion of the cranium between the orbit. Where it forms the roof of nasal cavity. So ethmoid bone forms the roof of nasal cavity. The inferior projection is called a perpendicular plate. The inferior projection of ethmoid bone is forms perpendicular plate. So the upper portion of the nasal septum. So the nasal septum is two portion. The upper portion is perpendicular plate of ethmoid bone. The upper portion is the perpendicular plate of ethmoid bone. So forms the lower part is the vomer. So forms the superior and middle nasal conchae. By the way, epidemoid bone, ethmoid bone forms the superior and the middle nasal conchae. But the inferior nasal conchae is a separate bone, separate facial bone. They are paired, separate facial bone. But superior and middle is formed from ethmoid bone. Slows airflow toward humidify and remove dust. This superior and middle nasal conchae is very important to slow the speed of airflow. In that case, when the speed decreases, the air became warm, humidified, and the dust can be cleared. So the other part of the ethmoid bone is cribriform plate. Cribriform plate forms the roof of the nasal cavity. So the roof of nasal cavity and olfactory nerve passes through this cribriform holes. So the other is cristagalli. Cristagalli is a groove which is found between the cribriform plate. So this is a triangular process projecting upward from the cribriform plate, which serves as a point of attachment for meninges. So meninges is the covering of the brain. So meninges to the brain is known as cranial meninges, meninges to the spinal cord is spinal meninges. So the cranial meninges is attached in the cribriform plate. Cristagalli is used as attachment for meninges, okay? meninges. So vestagialis also it is projecting apart from the cribriform plate. That's found between the cribriform plate. So yeah, this is a anterior view of the ethmoid bone. Ethmoid bone is it seems like the plane, airplane. So or aeroplane. So this hole, this small hole is known as cribriform plate, but between the two cribriform plate or projecting from the cribriform plate is known as crista galli. Crista galli, this is the groove. The projected part is known as crista galli. The projected process is crista galli. It's important for attachment, for insertion of cranial meninges of the brain. So the other is this is the superior nasal conchae. This is the inferior nasal conchae. This is the superior nasal conchae. This is the middle nasal conchae. So this is a part of ethmoid bone. So this is very important structure, is known as perpendicular plate. This perpendicular plate is important to form the superior portion of the nasal septum, whereas this part is important for to slow the process of the speed of the air to in order to make warm, humidify and clearing the air. So this is a perpendicular plate, this is a nasal conchus, and the other is this is known as these grooves are known as ethmoidal labernis containing lateral processes, and there are foraminas, and cribriform plate is here, crista galli is here, perpendicular plate is here. So this is the anterior view. So this is the roof of the nasal cavity. This cribriform plate, this olfactory nerve passes from the cranium to the nose. So now we are looking for a cranial fossa. Cranial fossa is the base of the cranium. So cranial fossa, curving depression of the cranial floor, the floor, the base of the cranium. So anterior we do have three types of fossa: anterior cranial fossa, middle cranial fossa, and posterior cranial fossa. Anterior cranial fossa is formed by frontal bone, ethmoid bone, lesser wing of sphenoid bone, lesser wing of sphenoid bone, whereas implacis, frontal bones of cerebral hemisphere. Middle cranial fossa is formed by sphenoid bone, temporal bone, and parental bone. Implacis, the temporal lobes of the cerebral hemisphere, the diencephalon and mesencephalon. Posterior cranial fossa is formed by primarily by occipital bone, with contributions from the temporal and parental bones. Support the occipital lobes of the cerebral hemisphere, the cerebellum, the pons and medulla oblongata of the brainstem. So, this is the anterior cranial fossa, this is the middle cranial fossa, and this is the posterior cranial fossa. The posterior cranial fossa. Optic canal is found here, entrance of optic nerve. This is anterior clinoid process, this is posterior clinoid process, and this is foramen laceram, this is foramen ovale, this is foramen spinosum, this is a petrous part of the temporal bone, and this is internal acoustic meatus, this is a jugular foramen, this is foramen magnum, and this is hypoglossal canal, and this is crista galli, this is cribriform plate. This is all. In general, this is known as cranial, all are cranial fossa, and this is the base of the cranium or cranial floor. The other is suture. Suture are fibrous joints where cranial bones meet. A place more than one cranial bones meet is known as suture. Suture. So this place is made up of fibrous joints. Fibrous joints. So four major sutures of the skull occur where parental bones articulate with other cranial bones. With other cranial bones. So parental bone is used as base for this articulation. So the first type of suture is known as coronal suture. Coronal suture is where the parental bones meet the frontal bone. Coronal suture is found between parental bone and frontal bone. And sagittal suture is where two parental bones meet. So between two parental bones is called sagittal suture. So this is a longitudinal suture. The third one is lambdoidal suture, where parental bones meet the occipital bone, between occipital bone and parental bone. The other is squamous suture. Squamous suture is where the parental bone and temporal bones meet. It's lateral, it's found laterally. So the other is fontanelles, Bergma and lambda. Bergma, Brigma is where the coronal and sagittal sutures meet. The coronal suture and sagittal sutures are meet. It's called Brigma. So this, by the way, Brigma is in another name, it is anterior fontanelle, whereas sagittal and lambdoidal sutures meet is known as lambda. This means posterior fontanelle in another word. So this is four types of sutures, okay? This is four types of sutures. Let me show you. So now, this is sagittal suture. This is sagittal suture, which is found between two parental bone. This is lambdoidal suture. This one is lambdoidal suture. This lambdoidal suture is found between the parental bone and occipital bone. And this is the squamous suture. Squamous suture is found between temporal bone and parental bone. So the other is, this is a coronal suture. This is a coronal suture. This coronal suture is found between the parental bone and the frontal bone. So these zigzag-like appearance are sutures. They are joints, fibrous joints, which connect this two or more than two bones. So now this is lambdoidal suture, this is squamous suture, this is sagittal suture, this is the coronal suture. So the next thing is fontanelles. Fontanelles are areas where sutures meet at features of the fetal skull. So an area or space where more than two sutures meet are is called fontanelle. Fontanelles are spaces which is the emerging or the joint area of the more than two sutures. So areas, fontanelles are areas of membrane filled spaces between fetal skull. So we do have six in number: anterior one, posterior one, anterior lateral two, posterior lateral two. In another, we do have, negligating the pairs, we do have four types of fontanelle: anterior fontanelle, posterior fontanelle, anterior lateral, and posterior lateral fontanelle. But if you consider the two pairs, we can say six. So anterior one, posterior one, anterior lateral, posterior lateral two. But mostly anterior lateral and posterior lateral is, they are closed when immediately before or after birth is closed. So the main prominent, clinically important in the prominent fontanelle is anterior fontanelle. The next is posterior fontanelle. The two are common. So anterior fontanelle, it will delay to close about 2 years, but posterior fontanelle, it will close starting from birth up to 6 months. So anterior fontanelle, frontal or Bergma, is a diamond shaped and the largest fontanelle from the six or four. So it closes around 80 to 24 months in average, but still it can be closed as early as 3 months. As early as 3 months or 6 months, it can be closed, but average carry from 18 to 24 months. Fontanelles give the following functions: allow molding of the skull during delivery. Molding of the skull means it's important for to mold or to pass one from the one sliding from the other of the cranial bones. Make the cranial bones, one cranial bone slide one over the other is called molding. Primitive free growth of the skull, bones and brain. Yeah, because of these fontanelles and sutures, brain growth will be permitted. Give signs for level of hydration and increased intracranial pressure. That means if the fontanelle, when the baby or when the fetus is delivered. If the fontanelle is bulged, it shows intracranial pressure is present, but and also it's normal, it will be well hydrated, but if the fontanelle is depressed, it shows dehydration, so it shows the level of hydration and signs of disease, and shows different skeletal disorders. How help to determine position of the head prior to delivery. When you take anterior fontanelle, so how the we can understand how the fetal skull is positioned, how the fetal position, because if anterior fontanelle, by touching we can detect whether it's anterior fontanelle or not, but not if we detect anterior fontanelle. If anterior fontanelle is found on the anal area, so the fetal face is positioned toward the anal area, and also so we do have different types of position in the delivery system, so it gives us a clue about the position of the head of the fetus. So this is diamond shaped, this is anterior fontanelle, diamond shaped structure is anterior fontanelle. So this is a parental bone, this is a frontal bone, but sutures, this is the frontal suture, this is the coronal suture, this is the sagittal suture. So found between anterior fontanelle is found between the three sutures, whereas this one is known as posterior fontanelle. This posterior fontanelle found between the occipital bone and the parental bone. So, but sutures found between, this is the lambdoidal suture, this is the sagittal suture. So this is posterior, anterior and posterior fontanelle is the most prominent fontanelle and known fontanelle. But clinically important is this one. Anterior fontanelle is clinically very important. So it shows different skeletal and medical disorders. And can be also measured, and the two lateral fontanelles is found here. This is known as siphonoid fontanelle, whereas this is known as mastoid fontanelle. So anterolateral is known as siphonoid. Anterolateral means siphonoid, posterolateral means mastoid fontanelle. So this is mastoid fontanelle, this is siphonoid fontanelle. They are lateral, they are paired, they are also two on the other side. So they are two, this is mostly, they are closed when it is delivered, or we cannot be easily detected, okay? We cannot be easily identified at delivery or immediately following the delivery. So that's why we are saying anterior and posterior fontanelle is more prominent. So this is about sutures and fontanelles, and there are research which is done on the anterior fontanelle size. So anterior fontanelle is the largest, prominent, and most important fontanelle, most clinical important, which is used for clinical evaluation. Yeah, it's clinically important. So it is mainly characterized by its size, shape, variation, and it's possibly influenced by gender. There is difference between genders. Male anterior fontanelle is larger than female. Races: the African fontanelle is very larger than white fontanelle, and genetics. And understanding of the variation of anterior fontanelle used for recognition of different medical disorders and abnormal skeletal morphogenesis. This is all about the anterior fontanelle. So in this neonates, anterior fontanelle is determined here by touching, by palpating. Anterior fontanelle is found in this area. So this is anterior, this is a sagittal suture. So this line is known as anterior posterior diameter. This is A is anterior posterior diameter, B is transverse diameter. So anterior posterior diameter plus at delivery, anterior posterior diameter plus the measurement or the value of anterior posterior diameter plus the value of transverse diameter divided by 2 gives us the size of anterior fontanelle. So anterior fontanelle sizes comes from the two dimensions, that is anterior posterior dimension and transverse dimension. We can give A plus B over 2 is give something from that size according to this research, and also to different types of research sandbox also follows this type of measurement. The other is para nasal sinuses. Para means adjacent, nasal means around. Nasal means nose, so para means sinuses, which is found around the nose. So the sinus are cavities within cranial and facial bones near the nasal cavity. So secretion is produced by mucous membranes which line the sinuses, drain into the nasal cavity. Serves as a resonating chamber. Resonating chamber means paranasal sinuses are important to intensify prolonged sounds, or to clear to produce clear sound, prolonged sounds, and lessen the weight of the skull. And lessen means to decrease the weight of the skull. So paranasal sinuses, one, it's a resonating chamber to make our sound clear. The other is to lighten the weight of the skull. So when we are caught by cold, common cold, some common cold variants. In some common cold variants, our skull became weighty or became heavy because of the closure of paranasal sinuses. So that means it shows us paranasal sinuses are important to lessen or lighten the weight of the skull. So therefore, frontal sinus, ethmoidal sinus, maxillary sinus, and siphonoidal sinus. Siphonoid is in the siphonoid bone. Maxillary is in the maxilla. Ethmoidal sinuses is in the ethmoidal bone. Frontal is found in the front bone. The largest is maxillary bone. Maxillary sinuses is the largest sinus from all. So yeah, so this is in front view. This is the frontal sinus. This is the ethmoid sinus, and this one is the siphonoid sinus. This one is the siphonoid sinus. This one is the ethmoid sinus. This is the maxillary sinus. So therefore, these are important for as a resonating chamber. The second one is important for us to lessen or to decrease the weight of the skull. So laterally, this is siphonoid, this is the ethmoid bone, and this is maxillary bone. The largest is the maxillary sinus, is the largest sinus. So now so it's facial bones. As we have seen previously, before, we have 14 types of facial bones. Two lacrimal bone. This is lacrimal bones are here on the side of here. Two zygomatic bone. Here is the zygomatic bone, and two nasal bone. This is the nasal bone paired. And one vomer bone. This is a vomer bone, and inferior nasal conchae. This is the inferior nasal conchae. It's a separate bone. Does not come from the ethmoid bone. Two maxillary bones. This is a maxillary bone. This one. It's paired. So palatine bone is two, and also palatine bone is are found in the base of the nose. And mandible bone is here. Mandible bone. So except mandible bone and the vomer bone, all are paired. Okay, all are paired. So there are 12. So with mandible and vomer, there are 14 bone. So this is all are the facial bones. Facial bones are here. Facial bones is here. So this is the orbital. This is the orbit, or orbital cavity, which is able is placed here. This is infraorbital vessel is placed here. This is a glabella. This region is a glabella. This is a supraorbital foramen, supraorbital vessel spathoid. This is a supraorbital fissure. supraorbital fissure, this is infraorbital fissure, this is different nerves in blood vessel pastoroid. So this is supraorbital origin, supraorbital margin is here, supraciliary arch is here, supraciliary arch is here. So this is a mental foramen, this is mental protuberance. So this is all about today's section. Next we will start in this part, facial bones. So please don't forget to subscribe this channel to get the next chapters and lessons. Thank you very much for your attention and watching for this video. Have a nice time.